Welcome to this lecture on the importance of energy use in buildings. My name is Paula van der Brom, and in this introductory lecture, I will briefly place buildings in the context of the worldwide energy use and CO2 emissions. We will also have a quick look at several types of buildings and their differing energy usage, and you will understand why this is such an important topic. The initial reason buildings were built was to provide protection from the weather. That is also one of the reasons why historical buildings from different climates look so different from each other. You can see an example of this on this slide, which shows some dwellings from different locations. On the left, a house in a hot sea climate in Greece. In the middle, a traditional house with a wind catcher in Iran. And on the right, a house in the Netherlands, with its moderate sea climate. Notice the colors of the building, the amount of window surface, and the materials used. But buildings also aimed to provide an environment where humans could perform various activities as efficiently as possible. This is the reason why we have so many different types of buildings. For example, offices, shops, dwellings, hospitals, data centers, and care homes. Up to the 50s, HVAC systems, remember HVAC is heating, ventilation and air conditioning, were very limited, so buildings had to be very adaptive to the local climate. From the 50s on, very powerful HVAC systems were developed, which made it possible to place any type of building anywhere. Poor thermal properties of the buildings are compensated by huge HVAC systems. That is one of the reasons why you often cannot see from the outside of the building anymore where the building is built. Complete interchangeability between China, Dubai and New York. A lot of glazing, or opposite, a very limited amount of glazing can be applied without compromising on the indoor climate. However, not taking into account the local outdoor climate in the building design will always result in the use of tremendous amount of energy. How a building is used, local climate, building characteristics, and its HVAC system together determine the energy use of a building. And this slide shows how surprising it may be. Here you see three faculty buildings on the TU Delft campus, no more than 200 meters from each other. All buildings are used for education and connected to a district heating grid. Make a guess. Which building consumes the most energy per square meter, and which one the least? Take 10 seconds to think about it. Yes? Ready? Here it is. In red, you see the energy use per building, in terms of electricity and heat consumed. Maybe you thought the most modern one was the most energy efficient. That is not the case. As you can see, the building in the middle really uses more energy than the two others. But the pictures also show us that based on the exterior appearance, you cannot determine how much energy a building uses. For example, the architecture faculty building uses almost the same amount of heat per square meter as the industrial design faculty building, despite their differences in construction year and design. But of course, we have plenty of examples in which an older building uses more energy than a modern one. Previous studies have shown that the amount of energy used in buildings is not only dependent on the building characteristics, but also on how the buildings are used. One of the first studies that showed is a research from Sonderegger, published in 1978. This research showed that energy use in houses differed greatly. 205 similar dwellings in the United States were monitored, and the results showed that despite the physical similarity of the buildings, energy use could differ with a factor of 2. This indicates that energy use in buildings is not only dependent on the physical characteristics of the building, but also on how the building is used. As you probably know, reduction of energy use to prevent climate change is seen as one of the main challenges of our time. This is, for example, reflected in the Paris Agreement, which was signed by 97 countries. In our agreement, the central aim is to strengthen the global response to the threat of climate change by keeping the global temperature rise this century well below 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels, and to pursue efforts to limit the temperature increase even further to 1.5 degrees Celsius. That energy in buildings is seen as an important topic is also reflected in policy. Almost every country in the world has various policies concerning energy use in buildings. For example, the Building Energy Code of Pakistan, the Nationwide House Energy Rating Scheme of Australia, and the Technical Regulations for Energy Efficiency in Buildings in Brazil. Here you see only a small selection of existing buildings and energy policies worldwide. Every country has its own policy to achieve the targets of the Paris Agreement. Some focus more on energy efficiency, while others emphasize energy taxes or renewable energy. It is not strange that buildings' energy use is a very important topic in all those energy policies, because a significant amount of the final energy consumption in the world can be attributed to buildings. In this picture, you see the final energy consumption in Europe for 28 countries. The final energy consumption is the total energy bought by the user, for instance, gas, wood pellets, or electricity. Very often in policy documents, the final energy consumption is expressed in kiloton of all equivalent. Let's take a closer look at the building's energy use. In this figure, the orange slice representing the energy use for residential building and for services, taken together, are responsible for 42% of the total energy usage in Europe. Residential buildings are houses and apartments. Services are buildings like office buildings, hospitals, schools, and shops. If you compare household energy and energy for services to the other sectors, you see that they make up the largest part of the energy use. Transport is responsible for 31% and industry for around 25%. Let's zoom in to the final energy consumption. On the left for the residential buildings and on the right for the services. Look at the dark orange slice. On average in Europe, space heating is very important. It accounts for more than half of the total final energy consumption. These figures also show that water heating also accounts for quite a large proportion of consumption, especially in the residential sector. However, keep in mind that this is an average. A new building, which are very well insulating, the share of space heating will become less, which leads to share of hot tap water to increase strongly. These figures also show that energy used by appliances represent a little bit less than a quarter of the final energy consumption. Lighting is a relatively small source of the energy used in houses compared to the services. The reason for this is that in offices, higher levels of lighting are required to ensure good visual comfort for the workers. And, of course, this is the average for Europe. In warm climates, the pictures will be different. Although in European countries like Italy, Spain or Greece, space heating remains on average quite important. The heat for cooling is much higher than average. It is not half, but around 30% of the total final energy consumption. In warm countries, with an arid or tropical climate like India, there is no heating but cooling and the use of fans, as you can see in this slide. This shows us that most of the energy used in buildings is used to bring a building to a thermally comfortable level. Of course, final energy demand does not explain everything, because in the end, most governments aim for CO2 emission reduction and preventing further depletion of resources. Depending on the energy sources and the final energy demand, the CO2 emissions can be determined. As you can see here, in an overview of the global CO2 emissions, in 2015, a significant amount of the total CO2 emissions are caused by energy use in buildings. To summarize this lecture about the importance of energy use in buildings, you have to be aware that reduction of energy use to prevent climate change is seen as one of the main challenges of our time. This we see, amongst others, in policies and regulations. Because buildings consume a significant amount of the total final energy use, they play an important role in achieving the energy and CO2 targets. Currently, most of the energy in buildings is used for space heating or space cooling. Energy use for appliances, lighting and hot water are only a relatively small part of buildings' energy demand. However, this will probably change in the future when the amount of buildings with a high insulation level increases. We also have seen that the users also have an influence on the energy use in buildings. But we also saw that in buildings with similar uses, the energy use per square meter may be completely different. In this course, we will discuss where those differences come from and how we can reduce the energy use of a building and even if we can optimize them.